darkest hour, in the dead of night, as the storm clouds gather and the lightning strikes and the thunder rolls and the cold rain blows and the future it holds, what God only knows,
what God only knows.
And I will rise up,
and I will rise up,
though I be a dead man.
I say yes and amen.
And I will stand tall,
and I will stand tall,
until I meet my end,
until I meet my end. You should have been on the level back in 1904. You could have found you a dead man.
And I will rise up,
and I will rise up.
Why be a dead man?
I say yes and amen.
And I will stand tall,
and I will stand tall,
until I meet my end,
until I meet my end. Now there's some in the kitchen, and there's some on the phone, ooh, and there's some in the graveyard, ooh, and there's some going home,
and there's some
going home. I will rise up,
and I will rise up,
though I be a dead man.
Say yes and amen.
For joining us for Rise Up. Woo! Are you guys excited that you're here today? Yes, amazing, amazing. Well, if this is your very first time here, I just wanted to extend an extra special welcome to you. And we want to say that wherever you are, whether you're close to God or you're far away from God, you are welcome here. And we are so thankful that you have come. Well, we're talking about restoration. That is our theme here this Easter. And if you couldn't already tell, you're in for a pretty amazing experience this evening. And we're going to weave that theme of restoration just beautifully. We're going to use drama and art and music and teaching and a powerful story you will never forget. So we are so excited that you are here. We're so excited about Easter and the possibility of restoration. Did you know that God can restore us? That he uses our fears and our failures, our struggles and our pain to draw us to him? And then, as only he can do, he heals us and gives us hope. He restores us. And the first thing we're going to do, or we're going to, as we continue on with our experience, our first little weave of restoration is a really powerful drama with three stories of three broken lives, three lives who are in need of restoration.
Waiter! Waitress! Anybody?
You gotta kill to get a drink around this place, huh? Hey, that's really nice. It's really, really good mountain.
I don't know about that. I mean, you just follow the instructions she gave, and it's pretty easy.
Yeah, really? Yeah. Really? Speak for yourself. Have you seen mine?
Well,
I know, right? It's pathetic.
It's okay. Good try.
Yeah, it is. Yours looks like mountains and peaks and valleys. Mine looks like a bunch of blue hairs just squirted all over my canvas. You know what's really funny? I've been to this place like three times. I think I'm getting worse.
Well.
I'm Michael, by the way.
Oh, Jennifer.
Oh, Jennifer. That's a pretty name, Jennifer.
Thank you.
Mm-hmm. So, Jennifer, is this the first time you've been to Paint and Pour?
Yeah, well, it's the first one I've actually gone to. I've been invited to about 20 of these at this point. I'm here with a group of girls from work.
Oh, yeah? Where do you work?
Oh, I'm a sales associate at Bed Bath & Beyond. Ah. It's kind of the worst.
What?
No, it is.
No,
yeah.
I love that place. Great towels.
Yeah, not so great when you're the one folding them all day. So what do you do?
Oh, well, not do, Jennifer, actually did. You were looking at the head of regional sales for the City Times.
Oh, the newspaper?
Yes, okay. Yes. Well, actually, ex-head. I'm not sure if you heard of something, little thing called the internet, Jennifer. Yeah. Apparently people don't read newspapers anymore.
Oh.
So I was demoted to an entry-level position, online sales. Que sera, sera. Whatever will be, will be. I need a new drink, you see. Can I buy you a drink? Would that be okay if I buy you a drink?
No. I'm good. I'm still working on this one. Mm. You know, maybe we should just focus on our paintings.
Can I be honest with you,
okay,
Jennifer?
Yeah.
I don't come here for the painting. Obviously, I'm horrible at it. You know what I do? I come here because I was just sick and tired of spending every night in a bar alone. Right? So I figured, you know what? If I'm going to lose myself in a bottle, I might as well do it here where I can pretend that I'm with a bunch of people. That's pathetic. Right? Yeah, have you seen that waiter? Waiter!
Maybe you've had enough. I mean, maybe you should just take a break.
You know, you kind of sound like my ex-wife. I'm sorry, I didn't mean that. You don't sound like it at all. She was a demon. She was terrible.
Okay.
She was horrible. You were much better than that. You were a nice person. And that's actually a really nice painting. You did really good. Do you mind if I just kind of watch you? Obviously, I can't do it myself. Can I just maybe watch you? Maybe I'll learn something?
Sure, I guess.
Thank you. You have really nice hands. I'm just delicate. That's all I meant. You know, Jennifer, you're really very pretty.
Okay, I'm sorry. Can you just back
okay.
up a little? No, really,
honest.
Don't.
No, I see how it is. No, it's fine.
I'm sorry. Just please, just leave me alone.
No. I see how it is. I offended you. I was being nice and I offended you. That's how that worked? That's fine. Okay, fine. No, you know what? I don't need this. I don't need you and I don't need this stupid paint and pour, okay?
Just relax.
What? Am I making you upset? Is that what I'm doing? I'm making you upset? Well, I'm embarrassing you in front of all your work friends, your cool work friends, right? And all the instructors. I'm sorry I'm embarrassing her. Right, this painting, it's very nice. It's beautiful, much better than mine. Yours is much better than mine. Is that what you wanted to hear? You know what? This is paint and pour. You know, I don't need this paint and pour, but what's a little paint without some pour?
What are you doing? Said you were gonna help me with the brownies, but you're not. Hey, get off your phone. Yeah, Dad's gonna freak out when he sees how many minutes you've wasted talking to your stupid boyfriend. Ugh. Emily, seriously, oh no, okay, that's okay. Oh, Dad's gonna freak out. Oh, this was the last thing Mom ever painted. Okay, just go here.
Sophia? Sophia, what did you do?
What?
What did you do? You just ruined your mother's painting.
I'm sorry.
Sorry's not gonna cut it. How are you gonna pay for this? Where's your sister? Emily! Emily, you're supposed to be watching your sister! Do you realize what you did? I can't... What am I... Go to your room. Just go to your room.
Oh, but Dad...
No buts! Go to your room. You're grounded.
I didn't mean to. It was an accident.
It doesn't matter if you don't mean to. That's not gonna cut it. All right, you need to get older, all right? You need to grow up.
What do you care? You're never even here anyway.
You know why I'm not here? Because I gotta pay for all the stuff that you ruined.
You are so mean. I hate you. Mom never would have treated us this way.
Sophie, you come back. Hello? Hey, Marty. No, I'm fine. It was just... Yeah, we just got into it. I don't know, she was home and she just spilled some stuff all over the painting. Yeah, it was Helen's. Yeah, the one she made right before she died. I don't know, I just lost it, and she just ran up to her room, and I don't know, poor kid. She was just doing what kids do, you know? Oh, yeah, you heard about that, huh? No, thank you, but it's BS. It is. I've been with that company for 16 years, and all of a sudden they say, that's it? That's it? I know it's a bunch of other people, but still, I don't know what I'm going to do. I mean, what am I supposed to do, Marty? How am I going to support the girls? I mean, it's just me, you know? Yeah, I know, but we barely make it as it is. I mean, what are they going to think of their dad when he's standing in the unemployment line? I know, but they already think I'm a loser. No, they do, Marty, they do. They think I'm a loser. They hate me. They literally hate me. And when they do see me, I'm mean. Marty, I haven't been the same since she died. She was the one that kept this family together. She was the glue, you know? She kept me together, too. Man, if it wasn't for the girls, I don't know. I don't even think I could go on. You know, you don't have to say anything. But it might help if you say something.
What?
I don't know. Your mother tells me that you've been very angry lately.
My mother is an empty-headed narcissist. All she cares about is how she looks in her yoga pants.
She says that you've been getting into fights at school. You want to talk about that? You know, sometimes when we're in a lot of pain, we use anger to help ourselves deal with that pain. But then what happens is the rage can eat us up inside, and then we begin to hurt even more. The only way to really stop it is to address what's really causing that pain in the first place. So do you want to talk about the divorce?
Cheated on him. Did you know that? Yeah, with, some dude from her carpool. How disgusting is that?
So how does that make you feel?
You ask me that one more time and I'm going to punch you in the throat. How come she gets sole custody, huh? How is that fair? Yeah, she's the one who betrays us, but my dad is the one who loses custody. How messed up is that?
Yeah, it's pretty messed up.
Oh, whatever. What do you care? I'm only here because my mom is paying you to see me.
No. You are here because you tried to hurt yourself. And I am here to make sure it doesn't happen again.
You didn't even fight for her. I mean, if my dad loves her so much, why would he just let her go?
You know, sometimes two people aren't meant to be together. Listen, it doesn't mean they don't love you.
Oh, nice. Where'd you get that? Therapy for Dummies?
Nice color.
Is it?
You like black?
Oh, what? Now you're gonna evaluate my psyche based on my choice of nail polish?
You know, I would appreciate if you put down the nail polish so that we can talk a little bit, discuss this.
What is the matter? Huh? Are you worried that I'm gonna make a mess? Is that it?
No.
Huh? Oh, I'm sorry. Are you afraid I'm gonna freak out and get nail polish everywhere? I am so sick of this place. I am so sick of feeling like I am just broken pieces of a person. And of everyone pretending like they can just put me back together, but you can't. You can't because you are all just as broken as I am.
Every one of the scenarios that we just experienced are in need of restoration. And I'm fairly confident that everyone here can identify with something in one or more of those real life dramas that we just experienced. And that's why it is so exciting, penetrating to talk about Easter. Because the story of Easter, the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, absolutely communicates restoration. Resurrection, restoration, renewal. And at some point, every one of us are going to need to experience renewal, restoration, and dig into the power of the resurrection. Now, there's different levels of restoration and renewal. Some don't mean as quite as much as others. Case in point, we've kind of had a restoration renewal on one of our professional sports teams. How many of you are Detroit Tiger fans? Raise your hand. All right. Oh, some of you are not. What are you, Cleveland Indians or what? I didn't see a lot of hands go up there, okay? Can I do that again? Do we have a few Detroit Tiger fans? And then we must have Yankee fans in here or something too, all right? Now, we have a new manager, and so that's kind of like a renewal and a restoration in some ways. And then, thank God that two star players, Cabrera and Verlander, that their surgeries went okay. And how about the restoration and renewal that Cabrera had pay-wise? Well, wasn't that nice? Go up the bat every time, $50,000. Wish I could hit a ball like that. Now, when you really think about it, the Detroit Tigers, that's good. Maybe that's why some of you didn't raise your hand. You're going, okay, sports are sports. But there's something far deeper. There's the restoration and renewal of the heart, of the soul. By the end of this experience, because of who God is, I am confident that every one of us are going to see that the resurrection story, Christ rising from the dead, is filled with restoration truths. Now, who was the guy that was the focal point? Most of us would understand that the focal point of the Easter story, of the resurrection story, was Jesus. Some people thought that he was really a good man and that he was a good prophet. Other people took him to be who he said he was. I am who I am, and I am God. I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life. There were those that would say, though, he was a blatant liar, or he was a little flippant in the brain, and he was a lunatic. Or maybe, in fact, he was Lord. What consummates in this resurrection story is this. There was this guy the week before by the name of Jesus who we're talking about who was hailed King of the Jews. They came out and they worshiped him and they waved palm branches. But isn't it amazing how fickle people can be? And within a matter of days, they wanted him crucified. What does that mean? That meant that he was slapped. That meant that he was scourged and whipped. That meant that he was put through one of the most ruthless, barbaric killings that could ever take place. And people hurled at him and went like this and said, "If you're the King of the Jews, then cut yourself off of that cross." Taken off the cross. Dead, buried. But there were followers. The followers wanted to go and pay homage. Like maybe you visit a cemetery and you go visit and to go to pray and to reminisce. And so these women came to do that very thing because down deep in their heart they still believed. And that's the scripture, because here at the river, we believe that we can get unbelievable sustenance for life out of the Word of God. And Matthew 28, 5 through 7 says this, "The angel said to the women who had come to the tomb, 'Do not be afraid, for I know that you are looking for Jesus who was crucified, who was beat. He is not here. He has risen, just as he said he would. Come and see the place where he lay.' And they ran in, and they looked, and they saw that he wasn't there. And then the angel said, 'Then go quickly and tell his disciples, he has risen from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. He will be there. Go and tell them. He will, in fact, be waiting.'" In this passage of scripture here, three short verses are unbelievable truths of how we can restore our life if we're down, and at the same time how we can live our life in a way that we've never lived it before, with God absolutely being at the core and the very being of who we are. I said that I would share several truths. The first truth is this. It was right in the passage. Do not be afraid. Fear diminishes. Think about it. What are you fearful of? It stifles you. It limits you. You feel just like that drama said, you feel broken. Almost every single time that God broke into history or broke in a significant way into the lives of people, he said this, "Fear not, have no fear, I am with you." Why? Because we so often can be fear-based. And to illustrate it just a little bit more, think about it. From these real-life dramas that we saw, addiction, drinking, and going too far, what does it cause us to do? It causes us to literally go down a slippery path that we feel like we can't even get a grip, and we just go into like an abyss of life. Right here in this scene, what do we see? Loss. Loss stifles us. Loss causes us to say things that we really don't want to say. Loss. We feel pain, and we lose our grip. And then, adultery causes pain, causes us to yell out. That girl, all she was saying in her brokenness was this: "I'm scared. I feel all alone. Can someone please, please, please help me?" And that's the meaning of Easter. Because God, what that girl was saying was, "Could somebody please love me for me?" The Bible tells us that God is love. And perfect love casteth out fear. Fear stifles restoration. Let me ask you a question. Don't think of anybody else but yourself here. What fear right now are you gripping? And as a result, it's hindering you from being renewed. The God who says, "Do not be afraid," does not want you to be fear-based, but joy-based. Not based on feelings, but based upon your faith and faith in God. We highlighted last weekend somebody here at our church, the Howell family, Mark and Christina Howell. And Mark has stage 4 cancer, and he's been battling it for about a year and a half. And when I got to know Mark and Christina, for his first surgery up in the Flint area. I wanted to go be with him before he went into surgery, and those can sometimes be uncomfortable situations to walk into. And I walked in, and there was his family around the bed, and there was his wife, and you could just sense a chill and an apprehensiveness. You never know what you're going to do, what you're going to say, how you're going to do it. And I was just trusting the Lord, and at the appropriate time after I'd greeted family and him and his wife, I said, "Can I pray?" Mark said, "Yeah," and I took his hand. If I remember right, I took his wife's hand. And I prayed, and I prayed a prayer that I wasn't capable of me doing. And as I was praying, you could sense the peace of God, which passeth all understanding. And I could literally feel Mark's hand just relax. Why? Because we called on God. God of the universe. The God who died on the cross, his name is Jesus, says, "Fear not. Fear not." The second truth that we get from that passage is this. How is it that we can fear not? There may be some skeptics here who are saying, "Oh, okay, come on." But where does that power or that reality comes from? It comes from the second truth, and the second truth is this. Jesus has risen. He is alive. Long before Jesus was crucified and he died, he said in John 11:25 this. He said, Jesus said to her, "I am the resurrection and I am the life." Resurrection means restoration. The one who believes in me will live even though they die. You may die physically, but you can live eternally with Jesus Christ. One of the greatest questions in the Bible is this. In another passage of Scripture, when the women came and the angel spoke, and every one of the Gospels, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, give us a different look at maybe a perspective of Christ's life. And this, the angel said to the women this, "Why are you looking for the living among the dead? He's not here." The reason that we can be faith-based and not fear-based is because we don't serve, we don't know, we don't love a God that's dead. We know a God who's alive. He conquered death because of Christ. Because he is alive, you can spring out of your tough times. Let me switch the gears just a little bit here. How many of you are looking forward to going on vacation? Ooh, that wasn't real. Are you guys with me here? Maybe all of you have been on vacation. Maybe you just came back from vacation. Okay, those of you who didn't raise your hand, okay? How many of you like to go to the Upper Peninsula on vacation? Ooh, that's not good for tourism. But how many of you have gone to the Upper Peninsula before? Okay, there we go. All right, that's better. All right, that's good. Governor Snyder will like that. And do you remember back in 2012 something that happened in the Upper Peninsula that really illustrates this point? Unbelievable, called the Duck Lake Fire. The Duck Lake Fire. Over 21,000 acres of land was destroyed. It decimated things. But you and I may feel decimated about something, but guess what? There's always restoration. Look what it looked like after the fire, and look what it looked like. Oh, by the way, the picture on the right, on the left, those were all jack pines. Those jack pines dropped seedlings. That undergrowth came in. In a couple of years, there'll be 2, 3, 4 foot jack pines there. No matter where you've been, no matter what you've faced, because of Christ in your personal life, just like in the woods there can be restoration, there can be restoration in your and my life. God can restore an unhealthy relationship. God can restore a loss of a job or of life. God can restore financial strain. He who is life can surely restore the life because he is risen. About 2 years ago, I got a call from somebody at our church. And by the way, I have permission I told them that I was thinking of sharing this story, and they said to me, and I told them that I was going to not use their name, but I still did. I have permission to tell the story. And they said, oh, you can use her name. We're not fearful of that or what people will think of us because our marriage went belly up. We got divorced. But you know what the exciting part is? Is they came and they said, we fear that we're going to be raising our son the wrong way, and we're wondering if our relationship can be restored, and can we get into counseling? And even though we're divorced, we'd like to get remarried. And just last summer, just west of here, in one of the subdivisions in their backyard, I did their ceremony, and they got remarried. And this is what they wrote to me. Pastor Terry, we are extremely honored and truly blessed to have you unite us in marriage and with the Almighty Father. We believe that through attending the river, its rich community, and the teachings of the Word of God, those are the reasons we've been blessed to be given a second chance. Please continue to pray for us that we might serve the Father and for us to actively seek out ways to be His hands and His feet. Thank you, Kevin and Linda Herpansky. You see, that's what happens when a person says, we're not going to fear what people are going to say. We're not going to fear what people are going to think. We're not going to go down the slippery slope of fear. What we're going to do is we're going to literally believe that because there was a God that rose from the dead, that we can conquer our fears and we can live life differently. And by the way, I said I was going to share several truths. Yes, don't be afraid. Yes, He is alive. Third truth is this: go and share. That's what they said. By the way, He is risen. He's not here. Go and share as quickly as possible. Do not hesitate at all. The great news that He's alive, and this is very significant. Go tell the disciples in the passage that we talked about. Go tell the disciples that He's risen. He'll meet you in Galilee. He'll be there. One of the great things about when we read the Bible is we can learn something out of one book that maybe another book doesn't clarify quite as much. In the book of Mark, it's very significant. The angel said, go and tell the disciples and tell Peter particularly. Peter, the guy who walked on the water, who literally had the faith to walk on the water, he looked away from Christ and he sunk. Peter was the guy who looked to Jesus and said this, I will never deny you, ever. And Jesus said, before the cock crows three times, you're going to deny me. And sure enough, they said, you're one of His. You follow. I didn't follow Him. I don't know. When He was being literally led away to be scourged and to be crucified, people said, you're one of His followers. Peter said, I'm not one of Him. Three times. He said, I don't know. I personally believe at this point that probably Peter was suicidal. Oh, God. I looked to you and then I fell. I said I would never deny you. God. Will you please tell Peter that I want to talk to him? Do you know what the lesson there is? No matter how many times we have denied and looked away from Jesus because of the love on the cross, He says, I want to see you. I want to see you. And look what it says in Luke 24:36. In Luke 24:36, it says, while they were still talking about this, Jesus Himself stood among them and said to them, peace be with you. You know what that says to us? When you absolutely don't expect it, God will show up. I'm not saying this to be judgmental. Some of you didn't even want to come today. This was the pass before you went out to dinner. But God wanted you here today so he could say to you, peace be still. You know why? Because Jesus wants mangled marriages to be mended, financial messes to have a makeover, broken lives repaired where addictions, gambling, drugs, and alcohol don't have to go down the path. Because he is risen, go tell the story that God takes emptiness and he gives purpose. Jesus is in the restoration, renewal business because he's the only God that rose from the dead and he wants to renew our lives on a daily basis. That's Easter. That's resurrection. That's restoration. And we have an incredible story that we want to share about restoration, about renewal, in video form. Take a look.
One of the atomic reactors at the Chernobyl atomic power plant near the city of Kiev was damaged, and there is speculation in Moscow that people were injured and may have died.
It may seem difficult to believe, but we know more about this nuclear accident than the people living in the Soviet Union.
На Чернобыльской атомной электростанции произошла авария. Поврежден один из атомных реакторов.
There are conflicting reports coming out of the Soviet Union. We do know that a zone of deadly radiation is being released from the damaged plant, and the accident is far from over.
Pripyat, Russia, 1986. During a routine system test at the Chernobyl nuclear power plant, a sudden power surge caused a meltdown that ultimately led to the worst nuclear disaster in history. The resulting explosion shot a cloud of deadly radiation into the atmosphere, where it drifted across all of Eastern and Western Europe. The neighboring Republic of Belarus was hardest hit, suffering 60% of the nuclear fallout. Though many were evacuated, the exposure to radiation had devastating effects on the population, causing radiation sickness, cancers, and birth defects. In the following years, children born with physical or mental deformities were often abandoned, left to orphanages and mental institutions that spent less than a dollar a day caring for them. Olga Deckman was one of those children. Born with one arm and dwarf-sized, Olga was left at the hospital the day she was born and subsequently taken to an orphanage where she spent the first 5 years of her life. Then, in 1999, a nonprofit organization brought Olga to the United States for medical treatment of her disabilities. She was placed in the home of Gary and Nancy Deckman for what was expected to be a five-week stay, but turned out to be much, much longer.
Our kids, probably a couple months after she was here, it was real obvious to them that this was a done deal. So we were going to do this. It was a matter of not so much if we would adopt her, it's when we would adopt her.
Olga's medical treatments allowed her to use her hand to do things she never could before. But living with the Deckmans changed more than just her physical abilities. It changed her entire life.
After being here in the States in this environment, I think it was going to be a significant culture shock. Plus the fact, given her limitations she's got, the opportunities for her were null and void. So at least here, not just with our family, but with here in this country, she has significant opportunities.
Watching her change as a person and watching her personality come out and watching her respond to love and affection and to a family. And I think we started to slowly see how she just was starting to thrive in this environment.
Now, Olga is doing more than anyone could have expected. She's discovered a love for photography, and in spite of her limitations, regularly works as a freelance photographer. But most importantly, she's discovered a love for Jesus. Olga is active in her church, volunteering 3 days a week and serving in the youth group. Her smile and spirit are a testament to what God can do to restore broken lives.
Thank you.
we're privileged today to have on this stage, and would you welcome in a great Easter kind of river way, Olga Deckman.
Your I've smile never is contagious. Gotten that before.
Well, that I guess that was a good Easter River welcome. We've talked a lot, and we've laughed, and we're here now. And my question to you is, what are you feeling right now as a result of walking out on that stage and this response and seeing that video?
Well, your guys' response, I mean, I'm just so humbled and blessed, and with the video, I just, God is so good. I just see him so present in that video, and just, wow, he's so good.
Well, you've come a long way, and you were in an orphanage, and do you have any recall of that experience living in the orphanage?
Yeah, I did. I people think that, you know, a five-year-old can't really remember a lot. I remembered more than you would think, and I just remember it being kind of dark and not being able to go outside very much, and we were kind of hidden in the orphanage, and when we did go outside, it was just so, like, eye-opening, and I just couldn't believe that there was something else outside of a dark, you know, orphanage or being in a crib, you know, that there was more than that. It was very shocking to me.
Now, you said something. You were hidden. What does that mean?
In Russia, like, handicapped people are not really looked, like, highly upon. Like, you're considered, if you're physically handicapped, they think you're just mentally handicapped. And if you're mentally handicapped, then that's definitely not good. You know, that you're just, any type of handicap, you're just considered useless and worthless to society. And that's just the culture. That's just for whatever reason.
But there was an organization that brought you over, and what was the name of that?
Project Restoration.
Project Restoration.
Yeah, it's kind of crazy.
Now, you're a second-generation Chernobyl survivor. Explain to people here what that means.
It basically just means that my birth parents were, when they were kids, they were exposed to the radiation firsthand, and, you know, radiation went everywhere. It was on the crops and in the food and just whatever else. And so, living a life, you know, when they had me, I was just kind of given those chemicals kind of secondhand, and that's what it just kind of gave me birth defects. So,
yeah, your birth defects aren't seen because you're pretty beautiful.
Well, I don't consider, I feel like God just really, it's really God ordained that I was this way, and I feel like, you know, I don't know, like, I mean, obviously because of God, I'm still here. And, you know, I could have not been here, but either way, if there was another way to relive life, I guess, I just think he wanted me to be handicapped. I think that was ordained by him, so.
I don't even know if I know how to respond to that. you say that because of Jesus, and there's some people that mean a whole lot to you, and that's your adoptive parents. Tell me about them.
They're very cool. I love my adoptive parents, and I just see them as basically my biological parents because I don't know my biological parents, and they're so rock solid in their faith and confident in it, and I grew up with that and having and was nurtured that, so it's been very easy for, not easy, obviously I have my ups and downs, but they're a huge reason as to why I even want to try and love Jesus, having the will to do that.
So it was when you could, absolutely. So when did you give your life to Jesus?
6 years old.
6 years old.
Yeah.
So you had, you 5 years old, you come, six years old, and tell us about that experience of knowing Jesus.
Well, so once it was kind of official that
I was pretty much going to be in with that family. I started going to their church, and I didn't really understand why we went to a church or a building and worshipped a God that we couldn't see or that we couldn't visit. Or, you know, I'm like, well, why can't we see him or say hi? Or, you know, and they're like, well, you can, you know, you just have to ask Jesus into your heart. And this was just one night, and I was like, and they're like, you know, you can do that right now. I'm like, ask Jesus into your heart. I'm thinking literally, because Jesus was in human form, and I don't want a human going into, like, my actual heart. So that freaked me out. And so I was just like, no thanks, I'm good. And they're like, no. Like, so my parents kind of cleared that up for me. And I was like, and then they said it in just a way that I just felt like, okay. They just basically kind of directed me through that.
Well, because some people may be freaking out too with that in the heart. Can you explain what your parents explained to you?
Yeah, basically what it means to ask Jesus into your heart, it's knowing that Jesus is your Lord and Savior and believing that and telling him that and saying you are the one, but then also admitting that you are a sinner and that you make mistakes and that your ways are not the ways of God, and then really just finally saying that, Lord, I want to change. I want to sacrifice my life just as you sacrificed for mine. I want to live for you. And there's no perfect way to do that. It's just however. Yeah.
But it's the sincerity of the heart.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, we're talking about the resurrection, and you wouldn't be here if it wasn't for Christ, and that is about restoration and renewal. What would you like to share about the renewal restoration process that you've had?
Well, you know, I've obviously had my fair share of ups and downs through. I've been through depression, and I've sophomore year and junior year of high school, and and then college was not easy for me academically with a learning disability, and so I kind of just went up and down. And after college, it didn't work, and I had to stop, and I felt like a failure. And so in the past 2 years, God really exposed me to this gift I never knew I had that he's given me. It's his gift, really, and it was photography. And with that, also in the past 2 years, I have recently gone to a new church called Grace Church. And finding a new church family, you've got to find a church family that is, because they support my gifts.
I just want to let people know that these are actually pictures that they're putting up on the screen that you've taken. And obviously Grace has allowed you to do that, your
yeah,
church.
Yeah, and it's been so great. I love it, and it's... they're so helpful, and to have some, you got to have people to help you spiritually. If you don't have people to disciple with or just people to help you, it's going to be hard. So,
sure.
Yeah.
Sure. Where would you be without Jesus?
You know, I don't really know if I'd really be alive, you know, emotionally, physically, you know, and even if he, you know, I just think that if I didn't know Christ, if I didn't end up in the wonderful family that I did, I just probably would have been really snotty and materialistic, because when I'm not focused on God, I'm just a mean person, I think. I mean, like, the love.
I'm sure nobody here can relate to that.
I mean, the love comes from Christ, and so, like, yeah.
Thanks for your honesty. Okay, I could ask you a lot more questions, but I'm going to ask you one final question. Great group here tonight, celebrating Easter. What's one last thing that you'd like to share with them?
It's just that God loves you. He loves you to death, literally. He lived a life to die on the cross and die the most publicly humiliating way ever possible, because he yearns and longs and craves your love, and he loves us dearly. In spite of anything we've done, of mistakes or who we've been or who we are, he loves you. And that's what today's all, or just Easter is all about. It's a celebration of love. So.
Would you thank Olga?
Thank you.
Wow. Thank you.
Thank you so much.
What are we, what are you going to do with what you've heard up to this point tonight? Not just Olga's story. Because just like Jesus appeared to the disciples, Jesus has appeared here tonight. He has. He wanted you here tonight because, like Olga said, he loves you so much so he died for you and for me. And I think that that warrants a response. And so we have other elements, but before we move into these elements and you listen to the words of this next song, I think we should just pray. Can we do that? Father God, I thank you for every person who is here right now, those who know you and those who don't know you, those who came reluctantly and those who came eagerly. And Father God, I pray that everything that has happened and everything that will happen in this experience in the next few minutes might just be catalytic in our spirit and will respond to you in obedience with whatever you're speaking to us about. Father God, we give you permission to speak, to move, and to change us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Came flesh and the light shined among us, his glory revealed. Living, he loved me, dying, he saved me, buried, he carried my sins far away, rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's come. Fire. rising, he justified freely forever. One day he's coming, oh glorious day, oh glorious day, glorious day.
To believe that that's what's going to happen when Jesus returns, because this isn't a fairy tale, folks. He came, he lived, he died, he was buried, he rose again, and he said that he's coming back. That Jesus, who they said wasn't the king, will come back, and every knee shall bow, and every tongue shall confess that Jesus Christ is Lord of Lords and King of Kings. And I wrote this down. Jesus is our Savior even before we accept him. But until we accept him, we have not been saved. Do you know that, Jesus? Because that Jesus, when we know him, changes us and restores us and renews us every single day. And if you don't know Jesus tonight, today's your day of salvation, and in a minute, I'm going to give you an opportunity to say, dear Lord Jesus, come into my life. I want to live for you. I'm not expecting it to be carte blanche, easy street, but I'm tired of living away from you, and I want to live with you. And then in your program, you'll see something that says, God, I believe you are a restorer. Please restore. And after we pray, the next song, you write in that whatever you feel appropriate. Or if you don't have a writing utensil, you take it home with you. Maybe it's your marriage. Maybe it's a thought process. Maybe it's an attitude. Maybe it's a behavior that you've been entrenched in and you've been going down a slope. And God says, you don't have to go down that slippery slide of life anymore. I want to give you life. I want to restore you. So let's just pray, and if you don't know Jesus as your Lord and Savior, you can just pray this prayer to yourself. Dear Lord Jesus, today I see you in a way that I've never seen you before. I ask you, Lord Jesus, to come into my life. Forgive me of my past, and may my future with you be a life that I could never imagine. Jesus, thank you for coming, for living, for dying, for rising and doing it for me. I love you. In Jesus' name, amen.
So we pour out our praise. We pour out our praise. It's your breath.
He is truly the King. And one of the reasons that we put on a presentation like this is not just so that we come in here, but we go and we live differently. We've been challenging our people at the River at a high level about, living life a little differently. And we challenged our people a few weeks back to do something called beans and rice. And we said, hey, would you eat beans and rice, and whatever money you save by eating the beans and rice, you can do it one meal, two meals, we'll do it for a week, then we're going to take an offering separate from our building campaign, separate from general giving, and we're going to take a collection because we want to support a ministry called Bountiful Harvest in Brighton, and that is a food pantry and clothing distribution, and they need some help with some serving trays. And then Peaches and Greens in the inner city of Detroit, they are the only produce place in the inner city of Detroit, and we're going to help them revamp their kitchen. Well, we've collected already over $5,500 towards these initiatives, okay? We're going to add some more to that so that we can meet the needs that they have. And so just want you to know that it's not about us, our tithes and our offerings, and if you've been blessed tonight and you want to help us propel the vision and mission of this church forward, then that's why we're passing the bags. We're going to crank it out on one last song, and I just want to say this. You didn't have to come, and you came. And I hope that you were challenged. You'll have an incredible Easter, and maybe you'll even consider coming back tomorrow at 8:30, 10:30, or 12:30, and bring someone who needs to hear a message of restoration and renewal, because that's what Easter's all about. God bless you. Let's sing.
Now. Thank you so much for coming out tonight, everyone. Be sure to bring a friend or a family member tomorrow. We're still here all day. And also, we're starting a brand new series the following week called The Big Picture. Come back and join us for that. God bless everyone. Happy Easter.